back to The Independent Pianist. I'm your host, Cole Anderson. Today's video is a continuation for my video from last week on Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, Chopin's Fantasy Impromptu. Although one of his most popular works has been alternately reviled and applauded by generations of musicologists and commentators. Although this work is certainly more naive than many other amongst Chopin's works, I believe it is this very kind of artless, naturally singing quality to the music that actually accounts for its enormous popularity. There's something very much akin to popular music about the ingratiating melody in the middle section, which lent itself so well to even outright plagiarization by 20th century popular composers. Take, for example, the enormously popular vaudeville song I'm Always Chasing Rainbows, which I link in the description box below. If you have to steal, then you might as well steal from the best. And in reality, there has been some thought over the years that the whole reason that Chopin didn't have this piece published in 1834 when he composed it, along with his Opus 17 Mazurkas and his Opus 18 Waltz, was because he himself was worried about the originality of his work. You see, Chopin does borrow certain elements from Beethoven's equally popular Moonlight Sonata, in particular from this spot, this short cadenza in the third movement. It's one of the most intense points in the whole sonata. Beyond that simple similarity, the tonal scheme of the two pieces is also comparable. C sharp minor, D flat major, back to C sharp minor. Although Chopin varies it a little bit by bringing his piece back to C sharp major to end. A significant difference actually from Beethoven's model, which remains resolutely and darkly in C sharp minor to the end of the last movement. Also, there is a slight similarity between the opening motive and the contour of the opening motive from an impromptu by Ignaz Moscheles, also published in 1834. I think this is tenuous enough that I have serious doubts that this was really the thing that prevented Chopin from publishing his own impromptu, although it is a possibility for your consideration. These factors may perhaps have had something to do with Chopin's hesitancy to have this piece see the light of day, although it's more likely that the reason he withheld it from publication was because he had promised it as a commission to the Baroness d'Este. And there does in fact exist an autograph from 1835 from an album belonging to the Baroness which bears out this idea. The autograph contains many variants that are at odds with the version usually played that was published by Julius Fontana, Chopin's student and friend, some years after Chopin's death in 1855. So if you're going to learn this piece, it's well worth checking out that other version as well. You might find that you prefer it. It's the version that's used in Arthur Rubinstein's recording from the 1960s, so you might already be familiar with it. Most of the alterations are of a fairly subtle kind, and the piece remains very recognizable whichever version you use. For myself, I actually prefer many of the details in the Fontana edition, so that's what I play here. And another idea, of course, that you run into often enough, as I've already mentioned, is this supposed homage to Beethoven, which would make sense given the quotation and also the somewhat Beethovenian way that Chopin emphasizes the tension, the polarity between tonic and dominant in this piece. Still, I have to say, these things seem to me to be somewhat slight to justify the extraordinary statement that was made by the musicologist and Schenkerian analysis expert Ernst Oster, who said that Chopin understood Beethoven to a degree that no one who has written on the C-sharp minor sonata or the Fantasy Impromptu has ever understood him. The Fantasy Impromptu is perhaps the only instance where one genius discloses to us, if only by means of a composition of his own, what he actually hears in the work of another genius. Well, I think that this is actually fairly absurd. I don't really think that's what's going on here at all. It's well known that Chopin did have admiration for Beethoven. He taught several of his sonatas to his students and played them as well. Apparently, the Opus 26 sonata with the funeral march was one of his favorites and may have influenced his own funeral march from his B-flat minor sonata to some degree as well. But at the same time, he had many misgivings about the kind of roughness of Beethoven's style and his humor, and the uncouthness of some of his musical gestures. And I think this piece is really exactly what the title suggests. It's a fantasy upon an idea. Chopin found this short snippet from Beethoven to be quite intriguing, so he developed it into something completely characteristic of himself. There's nothing particularly Beethovenian in the slightest about the character of this intricate, graceful series of embellished arpeggios that makes up the main idea. Neither is there anything very much Beethovenian about the very classically formed bel canto middle section, which owes much more to the operas of Bellini than it does to anything Beethoven ever wrote. I think it's still a fascinating piece because here we're seeing a wonderful composer taking a very interesting melodic snippet and tonal outline from another very different composer and developing it into a totally different kind of piece, a totally different kind of mood and structure, a totally different aesthetic, in fact. The piece loses nothing from its indebtedness to Beethoven, since Chopin could have used any kind of pattern to reach a similar endpoint. The fascinating thing is seeing the contrast of the very different ways in which these composers develop similar ideas. I think it should inspire us to appreciate both of them more when we see this contrast between them. Also, I think it's a great example for compositional practice as well. If you want to improve your own compositions, try Chopin's trick here. Borrow some ideas as a starting point from a work that you admire, but transform these ideas into something that suits your own personality and idiom. I hope this offers a new perspective on this often played piece, and I also hope that my analysis will help those of you who already love the piece to also better understand the craft that went into it. So thanks for watching, enjoy the performance, and catch you next week.